This is George Price, and I am with Mr. Donald E. Henderson today here on Christmas Eve. And just recently, Mr. Henderson left his post with the Pendleton Town Council. How are you, Don?
I'm fine, George. I'm wonderful, and I am enjoying the holiday.
Yeah, well, let me first of all say Merry Christmas to you. And
thank you.
Everybody. Don, can I ask why you decided to now leave your position?
Sure. Yes. I had decided several years ago, in my early 70s, that if I was still viable and I still was functioning by the time I was 80, I would be off of every board and commission that I sat on. And I, at the time, I think I was on maybe 10 or 11 different boards or commissions that I was involved with. And so in the last two or three years, I have begun to do that. I went off of the Corporation for Economic Development Board a couple of years ago, appointed Chet Babb to replace me on that. I went off the Council of Governments a year ago and put Bob Jones in that position to give them some experience outside the town. I retired from as chairman of St. Vincent's and St. John's Health System a year ago, and basically for that very same reason, and the council has been one of the last things that I retired from. But I decided that when I was 80, it was time to retire. And as you age. As you get older, I believe very, very strongly that you may feel good, you may have good ideas, you may have a lot of thoughts, but you really become less viable in the public sector and in the corporate world, because people want people in leadership positions, I believe, that they think are going to be there for a period of time to carry out the things that they propose. And there comes a point in time in your life, and I'm at that point in time, when you no longer will be there to see many of the things carried out. Some of the things that I've been involved with over in the town over the years have taken several years to accomplish. Right. They didn't. You don't just think of them and then they automatically happen, or you contact someone and they are taken care of. It's a case where it just takes several years for some things to develop.
Right. We're going to shift gears here just a little bit.
Sure.
We've got some folks probably wondering who is with you there. You want to tell us a little bit?
Well, this is Stella. Stella is our little dog, and she's been with us now about 2.5 years, and she's our companion. Shirley's in mine, and keeps us interested and active, and going. We had a dog named Cookie prior to Stella, and Cookie was aged and passed away, and just as a side note, Cookie used to like to lay here under my desk when I'd be out here in the office. Stella does that quite a bit now herself, but so I had we had Cookie cremated, and Cookie I have her remains under my desk here today, so. Just a part of the family.
Well, they become a very special part of the family.
Yeah, they
really
do.
If I got this correct, you first, after you came to the Pendleton Town Council in 1999?
Yes, I was president of the Redevelopment Commission prior to that. We had worked when I was still the Farm Bureau. As I was coming out from Indianapolis, I watched the growth that was coming out our way, and my concern was that we could very easily become just a bedroom community and nothing more of Indianapolis. And as I looked and thought about it, it became apparent that the reformatory had about 1,900 acres of land here, and out here, some of it laid out here on the interstate. And I felt very strongly that we needed our own industrial base in order to help pay for the infrastructure costs that were going to be coming our way, that would then, otherwise, if we didn't have an industrial base, would fall on property owners here in the town.
Yeah.
And I didn't feel that that was appropriate. And so consequently, I went to the governor at the time, and Governor O'Bannon, and I asked Frank, I said, would you entertain a proposal from me for what I think is some of the surplus reformatory land? And he said, yes, Don. He said, I would. What do you have in mind? And so what I proposed was that the town would become, if he would give us some land, the town would become the developer, and we would turn the sale of that land back to the industries coming in lieu of tax abatement, which would make them taxpayers right away and benefit the state and the community. And my comment to him was, he was from a historic town, the town of Corydon. And I reminded him that we were one of two complete towns in Indiana on the National Historic Register, us and Madison. And he agreed and thought it was a good idea, and it took us 3 years to get that accomplished, but he gave us 213 acres of land out here that we now have for our own industrial park.
Yeah. When you first came to the Pendleton Town Council, you weren't president of the town council. You was a member?
Yes, I served, George, I served, filled out about 6 months of an unexpired term of a member that moved away, moved out of town, so could no longer serve. And so I filled that term and then ran that fall for election, and was elected, and then was elected president at that time, and I've been president. I was president from 2000 until I retired here this year. So I was president of the council 14 years.
Yeah. What was the early years of town council like back when you first joined, in some comparison to what perhaps we have today?
Well, it was very, I'll tell you, it was a council that was very supportive and put the town their interests first. We were a divided council politically, and we've been that pretty much the entire time. There have been, while I've been on the council, there have been three Democrats and two Republicans, and we never approached things from the standpoint of what was in the best interest of the parties. It was always in the best interest of what we felt was the best interest of the town. And early on, I said that my feelings were that if we couldn't reach agreement on an issue or a problem, we would just let it sit, and we'd discuss it, and we would debate it. And when we reached a consensus, then we would take it to the public. And that's the way we operated, really, for many years. If there's been any difference in the last year or a year and a half, maybe two, it is that there's a feeling on the council that things should be debated publicly more, that they should be everything should be for public discourse and discussion, which is fine. However, I think in a small town, I caution people about that, because we all either are related to one another or we know one another, and if everything is confrontational, then you have a tendency to have factions develop in the town that I don't believe are in the best interest of the town. Now, that doesn't mean that there shouldn't be controversy. There are big issues that come before us that need a lot of public discussion and a lot of public debate. But that shouldn't be everything, because of being a town. And if you're in a city where people don't know one another and things are more controversial and or confrontational, I should say, I think that's a different environment. But in a small town, I think that it creates divisions within the town that aren't necessary for the most part.
Yeah. When folks come into the town council meetings, and I've watched you and the others several times, you come in, you have different things come before you, and you talk about them for a few minutes, and boom, you vote on them, and they're either approved or not approved. But there's a lot more goes on to deciding what is going to happen when you have the meeting than people actually see, isn't there?
Yes, there is, and while the meetings are that we have certainly are open for anyone's input, and we encourage people's input. I've always encouraged people to talk to us and talk to us individually, give us your thoughts and your ideas and so forth, which is always healthy, because this isn't my town or it isn't your town or anyone else's. It's our town.
Yeah.
And that's what makes it a wonderful place in which to live and work and raise a family.
And be part of.
And be a part of, that's yeah. Right.
Be part of. You were very one of the instrumental parts in this, but back in, is it 2001 that you finally broke ground and started the industrial park out on the west side of town?
It was, I believe, I'm not mistaken, I think maybe it was 2001 yeah. that was first got underway. We've signed all of the legal papers that transferred that property to the town.
Yeah. That had seen some immediate growth, and then it slowed down a little bit.
Well, part of that was by design, because Steve Paul had property and Manser had some development property on the other side of the interstate where Guide Corp built and now Remy is located. Tractor Supply was in Steve Paul's in part of his industrial area that he had. And the concern, and their concern was legitimate, that they were concerned because they had felt that maybe we would step in and undercut the value of their land, and we assured them that we didn't want to, and that wasn't in our best interest. So what we tried to do was to develop their land before we began to develop ours. Now, we're at this point in time now when our land can be developed, I think, without any problem, and their land is pretty well developed, I think, for the most part, and so we're at a point in time where we can begin to promote our land and maybe do so a little more aggressively than we have in the past. But the nice thing about that, having developed theirs first, that makes ours even that much more valuable. And so we are going to gain more from it than we would have if we would have developed it aggressively early on.
Well, it's a beautiful area up there, and it couldn't be more, you know, right off the interstate and right off the major highways and,
right.
and things. At one time, you had, if I got this correct, you had hoped that someone like Ivy Tech may be interested in that.
Yes, I had. I had hoped and even made some contact with some universities around the state, Vincennes and some others, but did not. It just did not materialize.
Right.
And yet, I would say, if the economy begins to rebound and we begin to see more activity. From a commercial standpoint, I wouldn't give up on that hope. There's still land out there that could be utilized for that very readily. Ivy Tech's biggest problem was we had interstate access, but we did not have the interstate visibility that Ivy Tech likes to have. And Ivy Tech, where they have located, new around the state, they are right on the interstate. Ours was just off. Like I said, we had very good access, but we did not have the visibility that they would have liked to have had.
And that's kind of changing a little bit, isn't it?
I think so. Yes, yeah. It is. And there may be. I think that there's still a good opportunity to maybe bring some. A university presence in here at some point in time.
Right. As you said, and as we all know, Pendleton isn't a large town. So the town itself is what, something like 4,000.
Right.
But still, it went through some of the very same things everybody else did. 2008, the budget of Pendleton is, some people wouldn't believe what the budget of Pendleton is today versus several years ago. How did that recession affect the town, the way the town operated?
Well, it did not have the impact on us that it had with other towns, because other towns, I felt, spent in excess of their what their budgets were. We were very fortunate in not doing that, and I give a lot of the credit for that to Tim Ryan, our clerk treasurer, and to Doug McGee, the town manager, because they both have been very, very prudent with money that was spent and how it was spent, and I felt have done so very wisely. We've used our town employees on a lot of projects that many towns would go out and cities would go out and contract to have work done, and that becomes more expensive when that's the case. And we have not succumbed to that, and that's helped us. And then the property tax caps came along about that same time, and that put a damper and has on communities' ability to generate revenue for needs that they just normally have.
Right.
We've been very fortunate from the standpoint that even with those property tax caps and less revenue coming in, we've still been able to function very effectively.
And as you said, that's starting to relax a little bit now, seeing some growth. But what do you think? Is there any important thing was learned from that, by Pendleton or other towns, you think?
Well, I would hope so. I have said through the 20th century, really it was a matter of how much more government could do and how much more money could be spent on various projects and programs and things that community wanted. And my argument in the 21st century, and I have said so from that time forth, has been that our challenge, our real challenge, is going to be how we do more with less, and how we do things more efficiently and with fewer personnel, and still get the same results. And I believe we can be more efficient in those areas. And the good side of a recession like that, it causes you to rethink what your priorities are and where you place your money, and where your tax dollars can best be utilized.
As I said before, I've seen you during town council meetings and for over the years, and some of the things that come before you are a little complex, but I've not seen many people who were as well versed in many of the all the issues that came before you. How much what kind of work's involved in some of those?
Well, I have to confess, it takes quite a bit of time, and it takes a lot of thought, and just really the effort of trying to do the right thing for the town and the community. And my philosophy has always been very simple, George. If I were asked to be involved in a commission, or I was asked to be on a board, or to serve on something, I tried to really get myself involved in it to the point where I could at least be somewhat effective and have some impact that would be positive. I've never believed in just sitting on a board to have it on your resume, because I don't think that's very productive. And so I can't honestly say that I've certainly, there's been a lot of people that I think have made some real contributions, and particularly with these complex issues, as issues become more complex, societies become more complex as well. So, I mean, we're not a simple society like we were when we first became a country, or a community for that matter. And so it requires more rules and regulations than what you would have had in the past. The one thing, though, that I think it's important to do, and I believe we've done this in our community well, we have focused and everything centers on us becoming and maintaining our historical identity and character. There's a lot of communities that do a lot of things, they do some neat things, but they seem to be disjointed. They don't seem to have a purpose and a focus that centers on what their purpose as a community is.
To stay consistent,
and you're right. And consequently, in our situation, we've turned some things down here that we just didn't think would fit the community well. And we think that in keeping our focus on our historical identity and character has served us well. And to emphasize that, I guess, the one thing that is the most significant to the growth and the well-being and the health of this community was the ladies putting us on the National Historic Register. I can tell you from my standpoint, personally, prior to that, we were a prison town.
I heard you say that.
And that is exactly what our focus was, and that was our main industry. And you did not, if you looked outside, and I've had people say from inside the town, well, Don, we've always been a neat community. We've always been a wonderful place to live. Yes, and you've been inside, and you've lived here all your life, and so that's an easy thing to understand. But if you're an outsider, and you're looking into this community, and you're going to spend, like Tractor Supply did, $16 or $18 million to come in and put a location here. They looked at us prior to 91 and would have said, no thank you, we don't want to be a part of a prison town. The ladies come along and had the foresight and the courage and the integrity to put us on the National Historic Register. And they transformed the image of our community to where the prisons are an afterthought. Nobody even talks about them anymore. And they talk about the historical significance of the community. And that's what we want to focus on, and that's what brings industry and commercial development, good industry and commercial development, to your community. We could have had, the only thing prior, I will tell you, I was on the Planning Commission back in 89, I believe. I've got the minutes where the only thing that was coming in or wanted to come in out here on Steve Paul's property was a mega truck stop. And we said no. That's our front door, and we are not interested in what a truck stop brings to our community. Brings all kinds of bad elements into the community, and we did not want to add to that. After 91, and then you begin to see the development and the ability to acquire the land from DOC. I could not have gone to the governor prior to that and got that accomplished, because his comment to me would have been, well, Don, you've got a primary industry in your community, now it's a prison. Huh. And what's wrong with that? Well, nothing, except that isn't what really we want our identity to be focused on.
One thing yourself and the other council members had sidestepped and tried to stay away from for a number of years was the growth. The
right.
Expanding Pendleton. During the last few town council meetings I was at, you seemed to be changing direction on this somewhat, as far as what's going on our borders with annexation.
Well, no, George, I have never felt that I have changed direction on annexation. People have always asked me, well, Don, what do you want Pendleton to be? What do you want us to become?
Okay.
And I've always said, I want us to be a destination. I want us to be an oasis, actually, that people want to come to and be a part of with all the growth that is going to be occurring around us. Now, that you cannot stop growth. What you can do, and what we've tried to do, is direct it. And directed in a way that benefits the town and doesn't make it a lot of separate entities that people want to come in then and change the identity of the community. Now, in order to acquire that, and in order to do that, we had to expand some annexation. We expanded to the west, first of all, in order to keep Anderson from driving down on the west side of us, right up against the interstate, and taking control of the west side of our community.
Right.
Now we have the same challenge on the east side, and the east side, we need to develop that east side, and we need to develop it, in my judgment, out of ways as we've done on the west side, to really give us some area for growth and development that we can direct and not be directed by outside enters.
All right.
That's our challenge.
You said, if I remember correctly, and I'm not going to try to quote you exactly, but there could be some impact on the north and east side regarding Anderson that some people aren't really aware of. Anderson can come up pretty close to downtown, can't they?
They can. They actually have control of control of annexation 3 miles beyond their city limits. We do not have control of that. So Anderson has control of annexation on the east side, down just beyond the schools, the high school and the middle school. And if they would come further south, they'd have control even further south than that, because it goes 3 miles beyond their city limits.
That's something I learned I didn't realize during that town council meeting. And you said that potential it really affects the viability of Pendleton as far as resources, perhaps.
Yes, it does. It very definitely does. And that will be, in my judgment, one of the challenges of the council for the future is the ability to continue to be self-contained and provide our own infrastructure needs. And we've been able to do that with owning our own electric utility, having adequate water supplies, having our own industrial park now. The other thing to add to that, Governor Daniels gave us an additional 111 acres of reformatory land out here, and we're going to develop 1,000 acres on the west side of town without any without any retention ponds. That is absolutely fantastic, because what it allows it to be developed safer, and it allows it to be developed more compactly, because you don't have any ponds or anything that take up space that otherwise can be utilized then for the development you intend for it.
You said that even now that you've left your position as town council president, you're going to remain active somewhat in town council as far as going to meetings and so on and so forth.
No.
George,
No, I won't. I can tell you, I don't believe. I think that it's inappropriate for someone in my position that has been active and been involved to second guess or to be a part of discussions and things that take place in the town after I'm gone, because I no longer will be involved in some of the additional discussions and all the things that come into play, like someone who is on the council who is accountable. I will no longer be accountable. And so I'm like every other citizen at this point. I'm entitled to my opinion. And it's worth what you pay for it, which is nothing. And I'm very sensitive. I hope I don't fall into the situation that I become involved in a way that is detrimental to the town or the council.
Well, I don't think you could ever be involved in that way.
Well, I would beg to differ with you, because I think that if people will come to you and say, well, gee, what do you think of this, and why are they doing this, and why are they doing that? Well, you can give your opinion, but unless you're really involved and you're there and involved in all of the discussions and all of the things that are going on, you can't make the same kind of judgment calls that need to be made by the people who are actually accountable. Now, it's fine for people that sit on, and I've watched this happen over the years. Well, boy, if I was in charge, I'd do this and I'd do that and I'd do something, I'd do it a different way. Well, then they go off and they don't have to be responsible for anything. If you really feel strongly about it, my argument has always been, hey, run for office, and if you get elected, you can do it however you think you ought to, because that's what elections are for. And once I have left, I feel very strongly that I will not be involved. I have not been involved with any of the boards that previous boards that I've sat on, and the same way with my being the CEO of the Farm Bureau Insurance Companies. Here I had the good fortune to be CEO of the largest domiciled insurance company that we have in Indiana. We have $2 billion in asset life companies, and we have almost $1 billion in asset casualty and mutual company. And you have to remember that when you're in a public office or you're in the corporate world, you are a caretaker. You are not a proprietor. And when you leave office, it's important to walk away and put that aside and turn it over to the people that are then accountable, and wish them all the best and be supportive. But remember, you're not a proprietor. Now, if you own the business, then you can stay involved as long as you want to, because that's what ownership is all about, and that's wonderful. But I would remind myself particularly, I'm a caretaker, and so now that I am retiring and walking away, it is not appropriate for me to come back in and be a part of active discussions. Now, if people want to come and they want, if any of the council or people want to come and ask my thoughts or opinions, fine. I'll be happy to share those, but I don't intend to make myself very visible.
Over the years, the interest and it seems like the participation in town council meetings has picked up somewhat, hasn't it? More people are coming to meetings, perhaps?
Oh, I think I think maybe it hasn't. I guess it hasn't. It seems to me it ebbs and flows. If there are issues that people are really interested in, and issues that they find controversial or that they want to have input in, they will attend. For the most part, though, if things are running well, if you don't have very many at a council meeting, it's a pretty good sign that things are moving along. Yeah, things are moving
going real well. Huh?
Yeah, things are moving along pretty smoothly, because I find people have a lot of other things on their mind, and they have a lot of other things they're involved in. They have things that they family and concerns and all of those things, and they don't involve themselves with issues regarding a town, unless it affects them pretty directly, or that they have a vested interest in something that they want to see happen.
It would you recommend no people, even though they're not a regular town council visitor, perhaps stop in once in a while and see what does go on?
Oh, I'd encourage that for anyone. I just think that it normally, like I say, doesn't happen because of the pressures that people have on their schedules and on what they what they're doing otherwise.
Yeah. What, get the phone on down here.
Quiet.
What would you have any last words of advice for who's left on the town council now, who continues on down this journey here?
Not really. I think that what they do and how they do things is they will operate in the best interest of the community. No, I think that here again, I don't think it's appropriate for me to advise other council members. They have been elected just like I was. They are all sincere. They're good people. They are doing what they think is in the best interest of the town. And as long as they keep that focus and try their best to do the right thing, we'll get along just fine.
Anything else you'd like to say, sir?
I can't think of it. George, I probably have said said more things than people would be interested in hearing anyway.
I'm very sure they will today and in years to come. What now? What's your plans now?
Oh, my plans now? Well, I certainly want to spend more time with the family and with doing things. My Shirley and I, Shirley's not very mobile, and I intend to be more helpful to her here. And from a family standpoint, I want to spend more time on the farm. I've neglected the farm the last couple of years, particularly just because of the pressure of things that I'm involved with. So I really enjoy the farm a lot, and I want to spend some time there. I'm going to also take up again my clarinet that I played when I was younger, and I've always had a desire to play the piano, and I want to give that some thought and some time. There'll be things that will come along, I'm sure, that I will be involved with. I don't know what they might be, but hopefully if I can make a contribution in a way that's positive, I will. But from the standpoint of what I do now specifically, those are probably the most specific things. And I'll be honest with you, I'm really looking forward to having some time that I don't have meetings to attend, and I don't have things that I'm giving thought to that have been and do get more demanding, I guess, all the time.
All right. Well, we appreciate it very much, and thank you for taking time on this Christmas Eve to speak with us.
Well, George, I want to thank you for taking the time to come out and sit down and visit with me. I've enjoyed it very much, and I've enjoyed your participation in our council meetings.
Thank you very much.
You do a very nice job.
Thank you. Well, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you and your family.